angels waging war in the unseen realm. Global events fulfilling biblical prophecy. Eternal life. What lies beyond mortality? From analyzing the paranormal from a biblical worldview to the discussion of cutting-edge science and technology, conspiracy, discovery, special investigative reports. Unafraid to explore the challenging issues facing humanity, welcome to another edition of Skywatch TV. Special investigative report.
How can modern super string theory from physics empower Bible believers like you and me to wage spiritual war? That is one of the questions we'll address tonight. Welcome to Skywatch TV. I'm Derek Gilbert. Joining me in studio, the host of Into the Multiverse with Josh Peck, author of Quantum Creation and Cherubim Chariots. That would be the aforementioned Mr. Peck.
Thanks, Derek. Glad to be here.
And the author of a book that's been, this has been a fascinating conversation, and we're just scratching the surface of it. He is the founder and chancellor of Biblical Life Seminary and the author of the best-selling Shine Our Directive. His new book is The Sheeriyth Imperative, Empowering the Remnant to Overcome the Gates of Hell. We welcome back to the program Dr. Michael Lake.
It's a pleasure to be back.
Super string theory and spiritual warfare. That's why we had to bring you in this program, Josh, because I have no super string. It makes my M brain hurt.
See what I did there? I see what you did.
So how does this fit together?
As I begin putting it together, when God did the original creation, he created the heavens, the Hashamayim, and the Haaretz, the earth. And Hashamayim is plural. There was more than one heaven. In fact, in the Hebrew, heaven in the singular does not exist. Hmm. When God created the three heavens, they were three in one, and just the same as we understand the Godhead, that he's three in one, the same way that man is made up, that we are spirit, soul, and body, yet we're one because we're a reflection of who he is. And so when he did creation, that was manifested that same way. Looking at superstring theory, they believe that there are 11 spatial dimensions to our reality. Hmm. One of the things that I propose is within those dimensions includes the first, second, and third heaven. And then the temporal dimension, which he adds on the first day when he said, let there be light, is the 12th dimension that he lays over the top of those. And 12 is the number of divine government. So before the first day Lucifer fell, God's response was he exercised divine government by requiring not only humanity once he created them, but even the immortals themselves for the first time were subject to time, and they had to move linearly through time.
That's why
the devil always plays checkers while God plays chess. Mm-hmm. It's because God set it up that way.
Yeah, sadly, we humans are playing tic-tac-toe. We're not even in the game. So is this what you mean by saying that God used time as a weapon against the fallen?
He did, because once he created time and subjected them to it, while God is omniscient, he is all-knowing, he also fills all time and space, the moment he said light be, he's already back in the millennial reign, he's experiencing it all.
Wow.
Because God fills all time and space exactly the same. But yet they are restricted to flow through time the same way we do. That's why the Apostle Paul said, if they would have known what would happen at the cross, they would not have killed the Lord of glory. And so they're limited in their knowledge, and they're limited by time itself. But when we talked about that war in the second heaven where Michael throws them out, the Bible makes this awesome statement. He says, he comes down with great wrath because he knows his time is short. If time has a beginning, time has an end, and it's not in for humanity, but when that time runs out, his time runs out.
Wow.
And that's why God uses it as a weapon against him.
So how does light fit into with time from a scientific point of view, but also from a spiritual point of view?
I think the different spatial dimensions, you can separate, we have our three dimensions that we experience here. After when Adam fell, now man was created to function in hyperspace, that there are components of us, our spirit can actually interact with the third heaven, our soul interacts with the second heaven, and then our bodies react here. And so at the fall, when there was that flaming sword, I believe that God separated the first, second, and third heaven.
Me too.
Okay. And so we need to understand that. But I also have something I call dimension zero, which is where Sheol is, it's where hell, Tartarus is. Can you imagine for a minute, this adds to the need to preach the gospel. What we experience as a day may be 1,000 years to them because of their relative relation to the speed of light.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Wow.
My experience that in the first grade, that last 15 minutes before the bell rang was as 1,000 years. So it was just a little bit of a sense there. Now, Lucifer, the anointed guardian cherub, the cherub who covered in the book of Isaiah, when he fell, he was cast out of the garden, cast off God's holy mountain, Ezekiel 28. You know, Eden was a garden, but also God's holy mountain. Did he have in mind a specific plan? And if so, what role did humanity play in those grand designs to put his throne above the stars of God?
I think that he was going to use humanity as a power source. That's what the Nekesh was really offering the garden. The lie is, I'm going to make you like God. Lucifer couldn't even do that for himself. And so he empowers the commissions the Nekesh in the garden. I don't believe it's Lucifer. Mm-hmm. The Nekesh is a seraphim. Lucifer's a cherub. I've kind of rattled around if they're just different manifestations and different dimensions, but when I begin to really find out that their jobs were completely different. One either proclaims the holiness of God, the other protects the holiness of God.
Hmm. The cherubim, right?
Yeah.
The throne guardian, essentially.
Yeah. Yeah. And so you have, that's why you have seraphs around the throne of God declaring holy, holy, holy 24/7. And so when you have Lucifer fall, who was supposed to protect the holiness of God, to create something different. You have the Nekesh falling, which was supposed to proclaim the holiness of God.
Oh, okay.
What a great act of treason was. Then you look at the Nekesh. I believe that Mark Flynn was right when he talked about how that he was a flaming serpent, so that when he appeared in the tree, he set the tree on fire with brilliance.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not by accident that when God showed up to Moses, it was in a little bush. You know, you need a tree. I can just take a bush.
Mm-hmm. And we see that in ancient mythologies like Prometheus and stuff like that, too.
The fire playing a key role. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And so from just a little bush, God was able to set one man on fire that took an entire nation down.
Mm. Yeah.
And then, but at the same time, the Nekesh started it in a tree. Jesus ended it in a tree.
Yeah.
I mean, the theme is all connected all throughout the Word of God.
Mm. Now, the reason we connect the Nekesh with the seraphim is because we see in the book of Numbers and in the book of Isaiah the word Nekesh and the root word of seraphim used interchangeably, so we can identify that as the seraph, but the cherubim, the guardian, you know, the anointed guardian cherub. So we've got two rebels in Eden.
Yes.
Is that correct?
Two rebels, and I think then at the Tower of Babel, we have principalities and powers fall.
Mm-hmm.
In Genesis 6, we have the watchers fall.
Mm-hmm. Mm.
And so we see this progressive falling away that happens in the Word of God.
I think that's an important point. I know we mentioned it in the last time, but I think it's important to remember because, you know, correct me if I'm wrong, but I think most people sitting in the pews on Sunday morning get the idea that the one dominant rebel is Satan,
right,
or Lucifer, who they identify as the serpent in the garden. They would be surprised to learn when you dig into the Bible, there's no place in Scripture that says that Satan was the Nekesh, that Satan was the entity who tempted Eve and Adam.
That's just a church tradition that we do.
So does that mean that the term Satan can be used for multiple beings? Because Revelation talks about the Satan, that old serpent.
When you look in the Hebrew, Hasatan is a title. Mm-hmm. It is not a name.
Mm.
And so any active player in the kingdom of darkness in any situation where they're opposing God's plan or God's people is a Satan. That's why it works so well in spiritual warfare. Satan, I bind you. Any element coming from the kingdom of darkness that has crossed my path, I bind you in the name of Jesus.
Wow.
And so it's a general title that has been ascribed to Lucifer, but it can be the Nekesh, it could be a watcher, it could be any player.
In other words, it's a job title,
it's
like
a job
prosecuting
title.
Attorney or accuser, and there could be different entities that inhabit that role at any particular time.
Absolutely.
Possibly, yeah.
That's amazing. You had mentioned Nimrod in the Tower of Babel, and in your book you bring out some really interesting information that brings the principalities into this. What can you tell us about that?
I think that what he began doing at the Tower of Babel got the attention of the principalities and powers. In fact, it may have been the place where they fell. And so one of the things they taught him as he began to build Babylon, mm-hmm. you know, is 200 square miles. I was kind of blown away when I found that out in the research for the Shinar Directive.
Mm-hmm.
But that the way that it was constructed to include the tower was to align itself with second heaven realities to begin to pull down power to empower the work. We see this over the years. Rome was built that way. Many ancient cities of powers, Washington, D.C. was built that way. It goes back to the teachings of Hermes Trismegistus, and some even wonder if that's just another name for Nimrod, or was it a watcher, just exactly who this individual was. But his basic concept is, as above, so below. You build a city to align with that power. That power source, then you can begin pulling from that power source to control and rule and suppress the people.
So is this like a twist of something of God's? Because we in Scripture we read about the Jerusalem above and the Jerusalem below. So is this like the enemy's twisting of something that's supposed to be holy?
It can be. We're supposed to align with the throne of God. And in fact, one of the things that I've seen, I've had to try to help people, that some Bible teachers are going around teaching people to open up portals. No.
Yeah. Oh,
right. The only thing that we have a right to open up a portal to is the second heaven, and there's a whole bunch of bad beans up there that you do not want to open up. And we've actually had to counsel people that did what these people shared on their shows, and they had demonic forces begin to be loosed in their house. What we need to realize is, when I live the Word, when I'm yielding to the Holy Spirit, the way that I live is opening up a portal to the throne of God to interact in my life. And that's the way it's supposed to be done.
We're in the middle of a 5-week series, special reports on Skywatch TV, dealing with the supernatural war around us and then how we in the last days are being empowered to fight back. The new book by Dr. Michael Lake is one of the 3 books that are featured during this 5-week series. We'll tell you how you can get those in just a second. And when we come back, we'll talk about how the modern Christian church is going along with the plan of the enemy. That's next on Skywatch TV.
Many ancient prophets foresaw Abaddon rising from the underworld in this very age. The satanic human sacrifice by CERN employees in front of the god Shiva was called parody. But all occult masters understand that symbolism was a powerful invitation for a doorway to be opened at CERN.
The secret origins of CERN are nefarious to the core.
Sergio Bertolucci, the science director at CERN, admits that they're trying to open a doorway to a parallel reality, and they hope that something, unknown unknowns, he calls them, will come through it. And CERN was built right over Apollyacum, where the ancients believed the doorway to Abaddon and the bottomless pit exists.
Is the bottomless pit from Revelation chapter 9 about to open? The biggest and most secretive investigation ever is set to be published, disclosing what no report has done before in Abaddon Ascending.
Technology today is being developed so that we can communicate with extra-dimensional entities.
The ancient conspiracy at the center of CERN's most secretive mission. But how will God's people, the remnant, prevail over the principalities of darkness during the final showdown between heaven and hell? Though hell may have its directive, heaven has its imperative. Increasing evidence from around the globe of miracles, healings, and prophetic visions indicate that God is already raising up an army of believers for the greatest awakening yet. Coming this December, internationally acclaimed best-selling authors and researchers Dr. Thomas Horn, author and researcher of quantum physics Josh Peck, college president Dr. Michael Lake, investigative researcher Reverend Donna Howell, and the host of Southwest Radio Ministries, Dr. Larry Spargimino. A research finale so huge and important it had to be published in a new 3-book collection. Abaddon Ascending. The ancient conspiracy at the center of CERN's most secretive mission. The Sheeriyth Imperative. Empowering the remnant to overcome the gates of hell.
He always has a plan. He's playing chess while the devil's playing checkers.
Final Fire. Is the next great awakening right around the corner?
There are signs all around the world right now that we are on the cusp of the next great spiritual awakening.
There is revival breaking out now where there has never been the faith.
This three-book collection, available December 6, 2016. For more details, log on to skywatchtv.com. Coming exclusively from Skywatch TV for a very limited time starting December 6, 2016. When you purchase the new three-book special investigative research collection, Abaddon Ascending, Final Fire, and the Sheeriyth Imperative from SkywatchTV.com, you'll receive the largest giveaway in Skywatch TV history. An unprecedented value of over $400 in free books, DVDs, audio files, and the never-before-released data DVD library from Dr. Michael Lake on The Sheeriyth Imperative, which includes 56 Christian classic works on PDF, all 28 episodes in Dr. Michael Lake's Understanding the Kingdom audio series, the latest version of Eastward for Windows, the three-part Into the Multiverse television series where Josh Peck interviews Dr. Michael Lake on The Sheeriyth Imperative, and nearly 3 hours of bonus interviews on video with Dr. Lake on The Sharpening Report. For your library or to give away as gifts, also included in this biggest giveaway in Skywatch TV history are Josh Peck's full-length 2016 DVD presentations, The Quantum Future and Extra-Dimensional UFOs, Dr. Michael Lake's full-length 2016 DVD presentations, Jericho, The Anatomy of a Stronghold, and The Shinar Directive, the new five-part Skywatch TV special investigative report on the books, Abaddon Ascending, Final Fire, and The Sheeriyth Imperative. But that's not all. You'll also receive the new Best of Skywatch Television on DVD, over 5.5 hours of the most popular episodes in Skywatch TV history. Travel through the multiverse on the new Best of Into the Multiverse on DVD, over 5 hours of audio with Josh Peck on the coming Technocalypse, the best-selling book, The Final Roman Emperor, an incredible 5-year subscription to the Skywatch magazine, 2 brand new free gift books, and the never-before-released data DVD library from Dr. Michael Lake on The Sheeriyth Imperative. For your library or to give away as gifts, an unprecedented value of over $400 in never-before-offered free products. This is the biggest giveaway in Skywatch TV history, and it's yours absolutely free when you purchase the new three-book special investigative research collection, Abaddon Ascending, Final Fire, and The Sheeriyth Imperative, for only $39.95 plus shipping from SkywatchTV.com, beginning December 6, 2016. But be advised, this astonishing promotion is limited to first come, first serve, while supplies last. So it's urgent that beginning December 6, 2016, you place your order for the new three-book special investigative research collection. This offer is on a limited time basis and will end without notification. So be sure to visit SkywatchTV.com to follow the updates in the countdown to the biggest giveaway in Skywatch TV history. The unprecedented value of over $400 in never-before-offered free products while supplies last. For more details, log on to SkywatchTV.com.
Skywatch TV is your source for cutting-edge information every single day of the week. Check out our exclusive web-only content at SkywatchTV.com and the Skywatch TV channel on Roku. Daily news updates, a look at science with Josh Peck, Into the Multiverse.
Yes, sir.
And, of course, on every Friday with our science advisor, my best friend and wife, Sharon K. Gilbert. Sci Friday from Skywatch TV. Teens Rock, a forthcoming program, and Skywatch Women also on the books or on the boards for the future. But keep watching SkywatchTV.com and the Skywatch TV channel on Roku for those programs. Michael, you mentioned in the book that modern Christianity is basically a willing participant rolling itself into Lucifer's plan. What do you mean by that?
Well, one of the things I document in my first book was that our theological seminaries had been infiltrated by the Luciferian elite in the early 20th century. Mm. And so they begin planting things. One of them is our jaundice against the commandments of God. Mm-hmm. Because in God's commandments, He defines what sin is. Mm-hmm. He defines what righteous acts are. Mm-hmm. I mean, God loved us so much, He said, listen, to understand this war, here are the basic definitions. The Apostle John in 1 John, which is one of the last books written in the New Testament, really brings that to a head as he's contrasting the Antichrist spirit to the Spirit of God, the Spirit of truth to the Spirit of error. Because from that we find out, if God says don't do it, how about this? Don't do it.
Right.
Because it's empowering the kingdom of darkness, not only in your life, but in your family, in your community, and in your nation.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's a return back to the ways of God. Now, in modern theology, we get into hyper-grace. And the definition of grace is not only God's unmerited favor. In fact, there's five aspects of grace. And one of them is God's empowering grace. Like Zerubbabel at the temple, when he said, you know, it's by God's grace that I do this.
Mm-hmm.
God's grace, when it transforms us, it then empowers us to overcome sin. But what we have done is we have taken the concept of grace and we have made it an excuse to sin,
mm-hmm.
because our theologies have gotten off because they have been influenced by the mystery religions.
Mm.
And we end up by our very violation of God's word, when we say that we're following him, but yet by our lives we're not. I wonder how much extra power that creates for the kingdom of darkness.
Mm.
Yeah, and you know what you say makes a lot of sense about grace being God, you know, helping us overcome sin. And something that you talk about in your book that's really, I think, suppressed in a lot of churches is the idea of fasting. And actually, I can speak from personal experience. Through fasting, I was able to quit smoking years ago, you know, through God's grace helping me get over that sin. Why is fasting so important?
I think it does several things. Number one, it puts your flesh in its place.
Yeah.
I think as we can suppress some of our fleshly desires, we begin to be more spirit realm conscious. In fact, there was a prophet that would, many times he would fast for over 20, 30 days at a time when he was doing big meetings. And he made the statement that got my attention. He said, after fasting 20 days, he said, I have to have my wife drive. I will no longer operate a car because I am more conscious of the spirit realm than I am the physical realm.
Oh, wow.
And so it's part of disciplining ourselves so that we become more spiritually sensitive. In Isaiah, it talks about that it's part of our combat. When you look in Jesus' day, the average Jew that was in the communities that Jesus ministered to, they would always fast at least 2 days a week.
Mm.
That was part of their spiritual discipline.
Hmm.
But the Laodicean church has laid aside all spiritual discipline. More information about the Word of God than any generation before us, we are the most ignorant. We reduce everything to a sound bite.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Yeah.
And what I have found is when you demand people to define their sound bites, they can't.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's presenting godliness, but it's denying the power thereof. And so we really need to go back to the book and let the Holy Spirit purify us, sanctify us. His ministry to us is to convict us of sin, of righteousness, and of judgment. And what I love what Jesus said about that, when you look in the original Greek, he said cosmos, that as we begin yielding to the ministry of the Holy Spirit, it even convicts the principalities and powers.
Wow.
Hmm. You had an interesting take in the book on what Paul called spiritual wickedness in heavenly places, spiritual wickedness in high places. How do you define that, and how do you see that as empowering these principalities and powers?
As I begin to look at everything, Satan always tries to mirror the kingdom of God. It's like an anti-kingdom. And God has a river that his power, his anointing, and everything flows.
Mm-hmm.
Lucifer does too, but it's fueled with the iniquity force. And so when you look at what the Apostle Paul was talking about, the principalities, powers, rulers of darkness, those actually have within the Greek, as far as I can tell, you know, there's an identity of an individual or a group of individuals that are connected with those. But spiritual wickedness in heavenly places is not, it's almost neutral. And so one of the things I speculate, that's that conduit or river of power that flows in the second heaven that's drawn from sinful humanity that empowers their work.
Hmm. Mm.
That's why if you have let's say a principality gets greed in this one town, it begins feeding itself.
Mm-hmm.
I think it could even empower things like during the French Revolution, the Gregorians, is that thing begins to take a life of its own and begins to empowering itself in the lives of the people.
Hmm.
That's what iniquity does.
Wow. So that's how iniquity can power the enemy. What about personal holiness? What does that have to do with like the armor of God?
You cannot put this, remember, it's God's armor.
Right.
And so the Apostle Paul does this long treatise, if you will, in the book of Ephesians. You got to put off the old man
mm-hmm.
with his works. You got to put on Christ and live the way that Christ did. He deals with all of that before he gets to the armor. because God's armor will not go on where his character has not been established.
Mm-hmm.
And so you can pray that Ephesians 6 prayer all day long, go into the battlefield, and really end up being wounded.
Mm-hmm.
And we're seeing that a lot in spiritual warfare because our theology isn't even allowing us to put on the armor. We're in the battlefield, in our BVDs, thinking that we're clad in the armor of God, and we're not.
Mm.
Because we put it on not by a prayer that we say, but a life that we live.
Hmm. So that's where our personal devotion to God's laws, his standards of holiness,
yes,
is what actually helps us be prepared for the spiritual war.
Well, it even goes back to the whole thing with Abraham. His halicha, his walk with God, is what transformed him. When I quit being religious and start walking with God, he begins transforming me. And that transformation, through the power of the cross, the old me dies and is put aside, and this new me begins to be developed that I can only be in Christ. And when I allow that to come to fruition, I'm clad in armor, ready for the fight.
Hmm. We just have a couple minutes yet, and I may be opening a can of worms here, but as we talk, getting back to the multidimensional discussion that we opened the program with, are there actual changes that take place in us that may not be apparent to somebody who's limited with the three-dimensional perceptions that we humans have, but changes taking place in dimensions that are not readily apparent to us when we begin to walk in his ways?
I think that because we were created to operate both in normal space and hyperspace before God divided it all, that there are changes within our soul, that the enemy, as we begin putting on the helmet of salvation, the enemy is well aware of what's going on. When the character of Christ is established and that breastplate of righteousness is there, I think that they can see that in second heaven realities.
Hmm.
And so, and I even think that even before we get saved, I think they can see the call of God on our life. That's why many were attacked even before they got saved.
Oh, wow.
Because I think they see so much more about us than we can see because of really seeing within the soul and within the spirit what's going on.
Hmm. I wonder then that, and this is a mental image that's come to mind a number of times, and it's based on something that Sharon wrote once about a woman who was a pillar of community, you know, an older lady. And, you know, she seemed like a small, frail little thing, but in the spirit realm, some of those praying grandmothers out there are the mightiest warriors that really drives fear into the heart of the enemy.
Well, there's a woman like that with the great revival that D.L. Moody brought to England was because of one woman that prayed, that because of the frailty of her body, all she could do was pray.
Mm.
And she actually prayed him from America to her church in England, and a great revival came up because of that.
Mm. The spirit realm is where the battle is taking place, and we Christians are, sadly, way too many of us, and I speak for myself here, blind to it. Dr. Michael Lake breaks it down, the Sheeriyth Imperative, one of the three books that we're making available as part of this five-week special series of programs on Skywatch TV, Abaddon, Ascending, and Final Fire, which will be featured in a program coming up. For Josh Peck, I'm Derek Gilbert. We thank you for watching as we keep watch. This is Skywatch TV. Super string theory and spiritual warfare. That's why we had to bring you into this program, Josh, because I have no super string. Is, you know, it makes my M brain hurt.
See what I did there? I see what you did.
So what? How does this fit together?
As I begin putting it together, when God did the original creation, he created the heavens, the Hashamayim, and the Haaretz, the earth. And Hashamayim is plural. There was more than one heaven. In fact, in the Hebrew, heaven in the singular does not exist.
Hmm.
When God created the three heavens, they were three in one, and just the same as we understand the Godhead, that he's three in one, the same way that man is made up, that we are spirit, soul, and body, yet we're one because we're a reflection of who he is. And so when he did creation, that was manifested that same way. Looking at superstring theory, they believe that there are 11 spatial dimensions to our reality.
Hmm.
One of the things that I propose is within those dimensions includes the first, second, and third heaven. And then the temporal dimension, which he adds on the first day when he said, let there be light, is the 12th dimension that he lays over the top of those. And 12 is the number of divine government. So before before the first day Lucifer fell, God's response was he exercised divine government by requiring not only humanity once he created them, but even the immortals themselves, for the first time, were subject to time, and they had to move linearly through time. That's why the devil always plays checkers, proclaims the holiness of God, the other protects the holiness of God.
The cherubim, right. Yeah. The throne guardian, essentially.
Yeah. Yeah. And so you have, that's why you have seraphs around the throne of God declaring holy, holy, holy 24/7. And so when you have Lucifer fall, who was supposed to protect the holiness of God, to create something different, you have the Nehesh falling, which was supposed to proclaim the holiness of God. What a great act of treason was. Then you look at the Nehesh. I believe that Mark Flynn was right when he talked about how that he was a flaming serpent, so that when he appeared in the tree, he set the tree on fire with brilliance. Mm-hmm. And it's not by accident that when God showed up to Moses, it was in a little bush. You know, you need a tree. I can just take a bush.
Mm-hmm. And we see that in ancient mythologies like Prometheus and stuff like that, too.
Fire playing a key role. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And so from just a little bush, God was able to set one man on fire that took an entire nation down.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And then, but at the same time, the Nehesh started it in a tree. Jesus ended it in a tree.
Yeah.
I mean, the theme is all connected all throughout the Word of God.
Mm. Now, the reason we connect the Nehesh with the seraphim is because we see in the book of Numbers and in the book of Isaiah, the word Nehesh and the root word of seraphim used interchangeably. So we can identify that as the seraph, but the cherubim, the guardian, you know, the anointed guardian cherub. So we've got two rebels in Eden.
Yes.
Is that correct?
Two rebels. And I think then at the Tower of Babel, we have principalities and powers fall. Mm-hmm. And so at the fall, when there was that flaming sword, I believe that God separated the first, second, and third heaven.
Me too.
Okay. And so we need to understand that. But I also have something I call Dimension Zero, which is where Sheol is. It's where Hell, Tartarus is. Can you imagine for a minute, this adds to the need to preach the gospel. What we experience as a day may be 1,000 years to them because of their relative relation to the speed of light.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
Well, I experienced that in the first grade. That last 15 minutes before the bell rang was as 1,000 years. So it was just a little bit of a sense there. Now, Lucifer, the anointed guardian cherub, the cherub who covered in the book of Isaiah, when he fell, he was cast out of the garden, cast off God's holy mountain, Ezekiel 28. You know, Eden was a garden, but also God's holy mountain. Did he have in mind a specific plan? And if so, what role did humanity play in those grand designs to put his throne above the stars of God?
I think that he was going to use humanity as a power source. That's what the Nehesh was really offering the garden. The lie is, I'm going to make you like God. Lucifer couldn't even do that for himself. And so he empowers the commissions the Nehesh in the garden. I don't believe it's Lucifer. Mm-hmm. The Nehesh is a seraphim. Lucifer's a cherub. I've kind of rattled around if they're just different manifestations and different dimensions, but when I begin to really find out that their jobs were completely different, one, either, well, God plays chess. Mm-hmm. It's because God set it up that way.
Yeah, sadly, we humans are playing tic-tac-toe. We're not even in the game. So is this what you mean by saying that God used time as a weapon against the fallen?
He did, because once he created time and subjected them to it, while God is omniscient, he is all-knowing, he also fills all time and space, the moment he said light be, he's already back in the millennial reign, he's experiencing it all.
Wow.
Because God fills all time and space exactly the same. But yet they are restricted to flow through time the same way we do. That's why the Apostle Paul said, if they would have known what would happen at the cross, they would not have killed the Lord of glory. And so they're limited in their knowledge, and they're limited by time itself. But when we talked about that war in the second heaven where Michael throws them out, the Bible makes this awesome statement. He says, he comes down with great wrath because he knows his time is short. If time has a beginning, time has an end. Mm-hmm. And it's not in for humanity, but when that time runs out, his time runs out.
Wow.
And that's why God uses it as a weapon against him.
So how does light fit into with time from a scientific point of view, but also from a spiritual point of view?
When I think the different spatial dimensions, you can separate, we have our three dimensions that we experience here. After when Adam fell, now man was created to function in hyperspace. Mm-hmm. That there are components of us, our spirit can actually interact with the third heaven. Our soul interacts with the second heaven and then our bodies react.
Angels waging war in the unseen realm. Global events fulfilling biblical prophecy. Eternal life. What lies beyond mortality? From analyzing the paranormal from a biblical worldview to the discussion of cutting-edge science and technology, conspiracy, discovery, special investigative reports. Unafraid to explore the challenging issues facing humanity, welcome to another edition of Skywatch TV. Special Investigative Report.
How can modern superstring theory from physics empower Bible believers like you and me to wage spiritual war? That is one of the questions we'll address tonight. Welcome to Skywatch TV. I'm Derek Gilbert. Joining me in studio, the host of Into the Multiverse with Josh Peck, author of Quantum Creation and Cherubim Chariots. That would be the aforementioned Mr. Peck.
Thanks, Derek. Glad to be here.
And the author of a book that's been, this has been a fascinating conversation, and we're just scratching the surface of it. He is the founder and chancellor of Biblical Life Seminary and the author of the best-selling Shinar Directive. His new book is The Sheeriyth Imperative, Empowering the Remnant to Overcome the Gates of Hell. We welcome back to the program Dr. Michael Lake.
It's a pleasure to be back.